we are going to talk about the random stuff I've written on the board. It's going to be mostly a plotting lesson, though there was one really good question people asked in their little slips they filled out after last time, which talked about what we discussed last week, characterization. And so I'll do a little bit on that first. The question was, great, Brandon, you've just told me how to kind of describe characters. How do I use this? Right? What good is it to know these sliding scales of characters? What good is it to know who my character is if I can't apply it? And this class is all about the application. Well, that will tie into what we're doing today. One of the main reasons I was trying to establish this for you and help you is I really want you to be able to know your character motivations, all right? When characters go wrong in a book, and we'll talk more about designing characters in our second characterization lecture, but when characters go wrong, it is usually because of motivation problems. The reader doesn't know why the character is doing what they're doing. Now, the flip side of that are when the characters feel stilted. This is where the characters feel like they are simply following a plot rather than being people. But this is also, at its core, a motivation problem. You are not staying true to your character motivations in that point. You probably have gotten your motivations across, and then you are having the character seemingly betray their motivations for the good of the plot. Readers are very perceptive of this. This is one of those things they notice. Even if they can't put a finger on why or what exactly is happening, they notice it. And so you, as an author, your job is to make these things invisible, to make them so when the reader comes along, they love the book. They may not be able to explain why, but they love it. Motivation. So we'll talk about motivation, but if you know where your character is on, for instance, the scales, or if you have your dossier, or whatever method you're using to build your characters, if you've done your free write and you kind of have a handle on who they are, then you'll be able to have them act in line with who the reader feels they should be, and if you're going to betray that, you'll foreshadow it so that the character's motives are changing, and the reader follows along and says, ah, I can believe that this character would do this thing that seems contrary to their nature because of event 1, 2, and 3. You need to have a good handle on your character before you can do any of that. Now, I wrote up here Superman versus Scrooge. One thing to keep in mind with the characters in using the sliding scales is deciding whether your characters are going to have motion or not. What are your character arcs? And we'll talk a lot about this through the course of the class, and it has to do with what we're talking about a lot today. I list these two because, not because getting in a fight would be very interesting. In fact, I don't think Scrooge would do very good against Superman in any kind of combat. Scrooge McDuck, maybe, but not the classic Scrooge. But if you look at it in their classic storylines, Superman does not have an arc. The quintessential Superman character is a character who is somewhat flat. And this is pretty if you're looking at like the Golden Age and Silver Age comics version of Superman, where we're using him as an archetype for that. It doesn't mean that there aren't good storylines with this character who have arcs, but in the general, the idea is the character is in the same place that began emotionally and things like this. Generally, they haven't learned anything. What they have done is they have accomplished something. Whereas Scrooge, if you kind of look at it, in the course of the Christmas Carol, he starts here, but his character changes a lot. He may not accomplish nearly as much as Superman does. Scrooge is not saving a city. He is not fighting off aliens. He is not learning how to shoot small versions of Superman from his hands, as Superman did once. that's true. Silver Age comics are weird. But what he has done is he has changed into a very different person over the course of the story. This is a character arc. This is not a character arc. Both types of stories are valid. Now, I would say that in general, what you should be looking to do is have both of these, right? To have a story that has great motion, something being accomplished, as well as the character becoming someone different, either that direction or that direction. These are much more uncommon. A lot of the best stories do these, but you can do both of these. But you can see there are many very successful and popular stories that only do one or the other. And your job as a writer is to decide where you want to be and kind of stay true to that. to understand the type of story you're telling and make use of the tools to tell that story, rather than letting that someone else tell you what type of story you should be telling. All right? So, today we're going to talk about plot. Plot as illusion. One of my favorite metaphors about writing, I heard it for the first time when I was a very young writer, and I can't remember who explained it to me, was that writers are very similar to stage magicians. A stage magician's job is to keep you distracted by one thing while they're doing something with their hand over here. And if you watch any sleight of hand magician show, you'll see just how good they are at it. In fact, there's one where Penn and Teller, I believe, do the famous cup trick, where they're moving the ball between the cups and it looks like it's appearing in this cup when they put it in that cup, but they do it with transparent cups. So you can see exactly where they are putting each of the little balls as they're moving around. It's really cool to watch. And I would recommend that to you as a writer because that's what you're doing. You are creating an illusion. While people are reading your story, you want them to feel that it is real. People sometimes talk about the idea of suspension of disbelief. That's part of this. But the whole idea is that you are foreshadowing in such a way that the foreshadowing is invisible, so that your ending is, as we like to say in the business, surprising yet inevitable. Now, not every story needs to have a big twist ending. It's okay if your story does not have a big twist ending. That's not what I'm talking about, though eventually I'll talk about how to properly do that if you want to. What I'm saying is you want to set up your story so that the reader is caught up in that story, enjoying that story, and anticipating what's going to happen while at the same time not quite knowing what is going to happen. There's a great essay I would recommend to you called The Strange Attractor by Terry Rossio. He's one of the screenwriters who wrote Pirates of the Caribbean. He wrote Aladdin. He has a website. He hasn't updated it in years. So some of the essays are kind of old, but one of my favorites is where he talks about the strange attractor, which is the idea that every story combines something familiar with something strange. Now, depending on your genre and the type of story you're telling, the amount of familiar versus strange may change in comparison to one another. Middle grade readers, if any of you are writing middle grade, one of the standards of middle grade is that you change very little from book to book. Now, again, any rule can be broken. Don't take any of this as law. But generally, this is what happens. So for instance, while the Harry Potter books are very middle grade, you see that the book's format change very little. The first and second book are very similar. It's an example of this. The series of unfortunate events are basically the same book over and over again. And as a reader grows older, they generally want the difference to become more and more because younger readers are still figuring out things that we take for granted. The tropes and this sort of stuff that we recognize, they yet have built, haven't yet built those pathways. Children's TV program, preschoolers, is even more formulaic. Blue's Clues was the one that kind of people talk about as kicking this idea off, where they would show the same Blue's Clues 5 days in a row, and the kids would like it more and more each day because they were figuring out at that age, oh, I can anticipate what's going to happen. I can guess and be right when I've never been able to do that before because I don't have the experience yet to do it. So on the third or fourth showing, they would love to yell out the answer because they can anticipate it in ways they never had been able to do before. As we get older, we generally want a little more of the strange. However, different genres blend these in different ways. Certain things like the cozy mystery. The cozy mystery generally does not have a huge character arc for the detective. Some of them do, but many of them don't. And they generally have the same sort of format. So the familiar is very familiar in those books. And the strange is, can you guess the ending? Which is often very hard to do and done in a clever and interesting way. And that is where the fun of those books come from. You're going to have to decide, where is my threshold for familiar and strange? How am I blending these together? As an illusionist, one of your jobs while you're doing that is to kind of hide your foreshadowing. But the other one is to give something I call a sense of progress. And this, in my opinion, is the most important part of plotting. Now, I call it a sense of progress because it is an illusion. Certain people are better at that illusion than others. Practicing will make you better. But it is an illusion. Why do I call this illusion? Well, let me ask. Plotting. Any given book. It takes that many pages to get to the end. Could it take this many instead? Yeah? Right? Write for me an ending to The Lord of the Rings that takes one sentence. Who can do that? Yeah, go for it. They flew the eagle to Mordor, dropped off the ring, and went home for tea. You laugh, but you could take any great story and you could boil it down to an unsatisfying one-sentence conclusion. All right? Could you very quickly describe how you would make Lord of the Rings take five times as long?
As it currently does.
Go for it.
You describe every single battle of the War of the Ring all over the world and have the main characters there for each one.
Yeah, there you go. Or you could describe, they decided to stay with Elrond for 10 years, and now we're going to describe every day of those 10 years. I think Peter Jackson would probably film it, and the extended edition would include the nights of them sleeping with just a camera on them. All right, that's an easy, cheap joke, I'm sorry. But you, as the writer, have absolute control over this. You have the power to make a million years pass in one sentence. And a million years passed. You have the power to make one sentence last 1,000, or 1 second last 1,000 pages. You freeze time, and you start explaining things, and you could just go on and on and on. I've read James Joyce books that feel like that. So, a sense of progress. You have absolute control over this. This is the number one thing I think you should try to understand as a writer working on plot, is that this is your domain. Now, your job when you're writing the story is to make it exciting. 10 years in Elrond's house explaining every hour of every day is not going to be interesting for most of us. Likewise, saying, and the eagles flew the ring to Mordor and dropped it in, is not going to have tension and excitement to most of us. So, sense of progress is about you creating that conflict and tension in your reader. And the tools we're going to talk about today are ways of accomplishing that. And a lot of people have talked a lot about different types of plotting and different formats of plotting. We're going to go over like five different schemas that people use for plotting their stories today. Most of these are for outliners, but we're going to do some pantsing at the bottom. That's what that word says that has too many flourishes on the G. We are going to talk about how you can have an eye toward this sort of stuff while you are discovery writing your plot. For those of you who are discovery writers, I think everything we're talking about today will be very useful to you, because the best discovery writers I know tend to discovery write their book, then look at that as a very, very long outline, and go back and revise so that then you build into the story a lot of these things that we're doing. So, sense of progress. The second most important point along with this, so one is sense of progress. Number two is promises. Promises. For plotting, one of the best things that you can do as a writer is learn to make promises early in your story, then learn how to fulfill them in a satisfying, yet somewhat still unexpected way. Satisfying, yet surprising, right? Promises. I often say, at the beginning of the story, it's like you're picking up the football and you are just hucking it, with the promise that by the end of the story, you're going to catch that and make a touchdown. The reader wants to know what kind of promises you're making. Your opening page, your opening chapter, will usually be one of the things that establishes this promises. This is, by the way, one of the reasons for the epic fantasy prologue. Now, if you've been listening the last few weeks where we've talked, I've mentioned that I want you to be chefs instead of cooks. The cook says, wow, a lot of these great epic fantasy stories have this prologue. I'm going to put mine on and make it similar because that's what an epic fantasy story does. The chef says, what's the point of this prologue? What is it doing for me? Is there a way to do that the right way? Is there a way to do that the wrong way? And the answer is yes. What does a big prologue in the beginning of an epic fantasy story give you? Go for it.
Well, generally it just kind of puts you into the world and it gives you a chance to look at things from someone's angle who's probably not going to be a viewpoint character for the rest of the world.
Okay, yeah, that's often what they do. Go for it.
I guess I've noticed that a lot of times it'll usually set up like the villain and then it will go away from that completely until you go with the hero.
Yeah.
So it's like setting up the promise of the villain later on.
Yeah, that's very good. Go for it.
It kind of throws you in a little further than the beginning of the story, so it kind of throws you straight into the conflict before actually setting up any of your main characters.
Right. It really often does that. Go for it.
It kind of gives you an epic feel because it's not about just the main, like if you started as the main character, you wouldn't necessarily know if it's an epic story, but having like big things happening at the beginning and then going there.
Right. Yeah.
Can I ask a question about that?
Sure.
So, especially with the like epic fantasy, it's kind of expected that there'd be like a lot of world building, a lot of the a lot of time spent like in this world. Is part of the solution that these writers find is to give you some sense of action and conflict with the prologue?
Right. And I'm going to explain this. The question you're asking is, yeah, people expect a lot of world building. They expect a lot of all of this, but they also want action and epic scope. So one of the purposes for putting a prologue in is to say, here is the promise of my tone. This is the type of book you are getting into. This is a book in which mountains will be created by people. They will have the power to do that. Kingdoms will fall, and you will see magic and mystery and power and all of these things. And then, talking about Eye of the World, you jump to a guy on the road with his father and walking away from their farm going to the fair. The implicit promise of this is, look, I just showed you what's going to happen in this series, so you can get excited about it. Now I'm showing you somebody who knows nothing about this. The journey of the book is going to be this person becoming like the people in the prologue. That is a promise that those books are making. Now, you can do that promise without the prologue, if you want to. For instance, I've mentioned before Indiana Jones, which I think has one of the best prologues in storytelling. The opening to the first Indiana Jones film is an Indiana Jones story in short. Action, adventure, some humor, you know, dodging things, dastardly villains, but at the end he fails. Again, there's a promise. Your tone is, we're going to get all this stuff. You're going to have an hour and a half to 2 hours of sitting here watching fun, wisecracking action with an awesome hero. And even though he failed at the beginning, the implicit promise is, he works hard and you're going to see him succeed next time. That's what the purpose of that prologue is. It acts as a hook, it acts as an establishment of tone, and it acts as a promise that you now get to see the character who failed succeed. Yes?
Can you drag out the promise of tone into the first chapter as well? Like a combination of the tone of the prologue plus the tone of the first chapter?
Usually. Can you drag out the promise between the prologue and the first chapter and say, my book's going to be a blend of these two? Yes, and a lot of books do that. You can do all kinds of stuff. You can do whatever you want as a writer if you are in control of, this is what I'm doing. And a lot of new books go wrong with promises of tone. There was a writer who, when I was a brand new writer, maybe 2 years after I published, I met this writer, we did kind of a little signing together, and he came over to me and said, you know, I've been watching your career with a lot of interest. I liked your book. I hadn't read his, but he liked my book, and he said, we published at about the same time, and your book really took off, and mine didn't. He was very frank about that. Very nice guy. I'm not going to mention who it is, but very nice guy. And he said, you know, I've always wondered why your career kind of launched off so fast, and mine kind of nosedived. And I looked at his book, and I remembered that I'd actually read a couple of chapters of it when it came out and had been bored. And I said, it felt like a kind of generic fantasy. You had the peasant in the woods, and, you know, one of his friends was, like, really good with the bow, and one was good with the knives, and then, you know, he finds out that he was the long-lost prince, and he's gonna get chased, and it felt like a lot of the same things I had read before. So, basically, I was saying, my threshold, as I've grown, as I've read a whole bunch more, and this generally happens as people read a lot in a genre, not always, but generally, means that my weight shifted toward wanting the strange, and this book had too much of the familiar, right? And he said to me, he's like, well, that's the thing. About the three-quarter mark of my book, I upend all the tropes. The book becomes, you find out it was never a standard fantasy, that this has been played all, the main character's been played all along, that I'm hitting you with these familiar tropes so that I can pull the rug out from underneath you and upend everything into this really complex, modernist take on the fantasy genre, which is kind of what you did with Mistborn, so I was surprised that yours worked and mine didn't. Now, part of why mine worked and his didn't is pure luck. Let's establish that, all right? This is entertainment, and entertainment nobody knows. At the core, why one thing works and one thing doesn't. But I've long thought about this discussion that we had, and I felt that what happened in this author's story is that he made the wrong promises. He promised a very standard Terry Brooks-style sort of Shannara plot, a very standard story that in fantasy, and I said, you know what, that's fine. There are people who are going to love that, but it's not for me. Because I've moved to where I like things a bit more strange. And there are no value judgments here. That's one thing you need to understand. There should be no value judgments between the familiar and the strange. You shouldn't be looking at things like Aragon that people fell in love with and say, oh, that doesn't have enough strange for me, ergo, it's not a very good book. To the people who were getting into it, it was exactly the right blend for them. But for me, this book didn't work. What I think the real problem was is that it got to that three-quarter mark. And then all the people who had been reading it and loving it because it was the type of story they had been promised suddenly hated it. And all the people that would have loved a modernist take and deconstruction of the classic fantasy story never got to the last quarter or third of this book. And so while the author was doing something really cool, it never found an audience because of these problems. This is something I think you should be aware of in regards to your promises. Now, that's, again, not to say you can't write that book, because there will be a few people who will feel like they want the standard thing, be reading it, hit that point, and be like, wow, I never knew that I wanted something so awesome as this. But for him, it didn't end up working. Another story of this is another writer I know. I can mention him by name because his books are very good and he had a successful second career. His name, he publishes under Jack Campbell right now. These are the, what's it called, Isaac? They're really good military science fiction about... Lost Fleet, the Jack Campbell Lost Fleet books, thanks. So the Jack Campbell Lost Fleet books, he published under a different name, John Hemery, a sequence of books that were basically described as, the TV show that was kind of big back then was called JAG, which was military, like, lawyers, right? And he said, well, it's JAG in space. I'm going to take a science fiction, military science fiction, and I'm going to do lawyer stuff on the big starships. And so it's going to grab all the people who love JAG and all the people who love science fiction. And it turned out it only grabbed the people who love JAG and science fiction, right? So the Venn diagram went exclusionary instead of inclusionary, and the books crashed and burned despite everyone really liking them. His publisher said, these books are really good. We think you're a great writer. Let's change your name and try again with something. You can't sometimes have to do that. You laugh, but it happens a lot in publishing. And so they did that. He wrote a new series, tried again, and these ones took off. They're all great books. He writes very well. But you can see that sometimes the familiar and the strange together, you know, don't work, right? Two strange things don't work. Sometimes two strange things really do work. Sometimes you're like, hey, it's like My Fair Lady mixed with Lord of the Rings, and you get Mistborn, and it works, right? Yeah. It's a teenage girl training to learn how to infiltrate noble society. Yeah, it kind of works. It's not how I pitched it originally, but it is fun to say. It's really more like My Fair Lady meets Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon. sometimes you can get some of these elements that are strange and blend them together and have something that really clicks. Sometimes you don't. So let's talk about a few ways that people in writing and in storytelling approach creating their plots. And perhaps the most famous method is what we call three-act format. Anyone here in the film department? Yeah, we've got someone, a couple of you in the film department. You guys study three-act format. You can tell me what I do wrong, okay? Because three-act format is fun. I have studied it enough to try it out a few times. It is not what I use, but it is very fun, and it is very interesting. Now, let's preface this by saying, have you guys ever heard someone say there are only five types of stories that can be told? Yeah, you guys heard this. You'll see essays occasionally. The nine types of stories that exist. And usually these essays are right. These are all lumpings of the types of stories that exist. But they're right in the same way that you can say, well, everything on our planet is either animal, vegetable, or mineral. Right? And saying, well, that means there's only three things in our universe doesn't really encapsulate the fact that you're stuffing a whole bunch under these umbrellas. And yes, there are only a few types of archetypes of plots, but you can split those into infinite variety in the same way that we have near infinite variety of animals in the animal kingdom, even though you can very quickly write on the board animals in one circle and pretend that they're all one thing. In the same way, you can look at something like three-act format, and almost every story, particularly Western stories, Eastern stories don't always follow this because they sometimes just kind of take out this one and start this one, like right here. Eastern stories don't always follow the same sort of things that we do, and that's cool to study, but generally you can take most Western films or books and you can put them in three-act format somehow. And three-act format is kind of very simple. You've got the kind of introduction and kind of the, I call it conflict, what do they call it? Yeah, confrontation. And the resolution. So introduction / setup, confrontation and resolution. This is breaking your story into three parts with an introduction. Your introduction. Your introduction includes the setup of the character. Kind of establishment of setting. And the establishment of tone. And all of these things that begin your story. These transition with what we call kind of a crisis point. Different talks about the three-act format call this thing different things. But the idea is that there is a point where the protagonist is forced to kind of make a decision, cross a threshold, and are forced into a plot from which they can no longer return, right? Things are never going to be the same after this point. This is the point where Luke's grand or aunt and uncle are found dead. I can't return to my life. Everything is wrong. Different people argue that the transition here is actually leaving Tatooine for Star Wars. You'll find all sorts of discussion on what this point is, but the whole idea is that you've got this main character and something happens where, you know, they've been called to action. Life will never be the same. I am leaving. Oftentimes I talk about this point as the point where the character transitions from being forced on a quest to deciding to actually do something on the quest. And in that case, the point in Star Wars might be the point where Luke says, let's go save the princess. But you can kind of decide where you feel this is. The whole idea is that there is this point, and then we transition into the confrontation, which is the problem. Usually we write this just as, things get worse. Right? this is where stuff goes wrong. Sure, stuff went wrong in here, and in here it really goes wrong. Some people say, you know, act one, we discover a character, right here they get chased up a tree, right here rocks get thrown at them, and right here, you know, they get out of the tree. The tree gets cut down. Well, this would be the tree gets cut down right here then. And then here would be we defeat the person who's throwing rocks at us. But, you know, it depends on what your problem is. Really, right here, by this point, if you're using three-act format, the big thing to understand is you have to establish what the problem that the character is working on is. By this point, you could ask the audience or the reader, okay, what is this character going to try to accomplish? And hopefully they will answer, this character is going to try to overthrow the empire that, you know, is hunting him down and building a thing that blows up planets. That's what you want them to be able to say at this point. That doesn't mean you can't mature that concept as you go along, but at least the reader should be able to answer at this point, I know what this character is trying to do. I know what this story is trying to accomplish. Right here, we have the low point. This is where it's kind of, it turns into do or die time. Usually during things get worser, the characters try a few things and they fail. And it gets worse because of their failures. And at the low point, it is now we can't fail again. Otherwise, the story ends, right? This is as low as we can go. The Death Star is now pointed at all of our protagonists that aren't on the ships trying to fight the Death Star. If it blows up this planet, that's it. We lose. Game over. And so then the resolution is, and it's trickier than it sounds, the satisfying conclusion. Where you make good on this promise. Satisfying does not have to mean the heroes win. It just has to mean that you make good on your promises, and the reader gets done with it and says, yes, that was the end. I accept that as the ending. Some films then do this and this, but we won't talk about that. So this is three-act format. Why is three-act format useful? Well, it's very simple. The simplicity of it helps if you've got a big story you're trying to tell, and you say, I need some structure for my big story. What do I do? You can look at something like this and say, okay, let me break down my story into three chunks. And the end of the first chunk will be where I've established what the characters are trying to accomplish. The end of the second chunk will be where, you know, they have tried several times and failed to do what they want to do, and now they're in very big trouble. And then I will have an ending where they either succeed or fail to do the thing they want to do. Again, this sounds very simple. In fact, you might be like, but I don't want to keep the formulas, Brandon. That's good. I'm happy that you want to keep the formulas. Remember that these are tools. These are tools to use to help you tell the story you want to tell. If this one doesn't work, try a different one. Okay? Screenwriting terms, there's a famous book that outlines all of this called Save the Cat. Has anyone read Save the Cat? Save the Cat is, depending on who you talk to, either the most influential and important book on screenwriting ever written, or the worst thing to ever happen to screenwriting. Save the Cat tries to break all of this down into little beat point by points, and actually sometimes assign time frames to when these things should be happening in a screenplay. On page 3, this is what you want to do, and things like that. A lot of Hollywood has been about lately, what page should this happen on? What page should this happen on? And at what minute? And each page of the screenplay is roughly a minute, so they can boil down to, in this minute, this thing must happen. That gets really strict. I don't like that. I don't even usually use this, really. But again, it's a tool that can work. If you want to go more in depth into this, Dan Wells has an excellent series of YouTube videos called 7-Point Story Structure, which is basically three-act format with a few other points in explaining important bits like the pinch and things like that about three-act format. It's very well done, excellent storytelling method, and Dan is a discovery writer. It was very helpful for him to understand these sorts of things and internalize them, so as he was discovery writing, he could be like, oh, this is what, you know, this moment is in my structure. Now I can keep writing and kind of have that under my belt as that's this point. Or after the fact, looking at the story that he's already written and dividing them out. So, three-act form. Any questions kind of on this idea? Go for it.
Yeah, for like a trilogy, would you have this in each book and then one that spans all three books?
Yeah. I mean, you could look at the Star Wars trilogy, right? The originals. So you can say that the first one we've been talking about, you could say that the first movie is character setup, setting and tone. The second one is, wow, things just got worser. And the third movie is, the satisfying conclusion. Oh, Ewoks. You could look at that. And usually people use the Star Wars original film and then the trilogy as an example of when three-act format is working. Because you never kind of feel like it's heavy-handed in these. You feel like it's natural. You get the kind of emotional beats and all of these things from that trilogy of films. So yes, this is a very good way to outline a trilogy, and everyone who's ever made a second movie in a trilogy has been trying to do this as well as Empire Strikes Back did it. It's generally heralded as the best second film of a trilogy of this style. Yeah.
How long should these sections be in relation to each other, and how can you tell if you're giving too much intro or you're...
How long should they be in relation to each other? Standard kind of story is the middle one's the biggest. And even some three-act format things I look at split the middle one to three little pieces itself. Intro is the second biggest, generally, and the resolution is generally shortest. You can tell whatever story you want to do, but that's the kind of rule of thumb. Is it's kind of like you could almost divide this one in the middle into failure one, failure two, and failure three. If you want to kind of really put a point on what's going on here. When is it too long? When is the intro too long? It's an excellent question. It's going to depend on when your reader is feeling kind of bored, like the story isn't progressing. The whole idea is this sense of progression, this idea that each of these points on the story are going to give a clue to the reader, we're moving forward. And if the reader always feels like they're moving forward and is always intrigued by what's happening next, you're probably going to be okay. Right?
So I'm a huge plotter, and I am having trouble creating a sense of progress in a story that is primarily internal.
Sense of progress in a story that's primarily internal. The last plotting method we talk about might be of help to you. So hold that question until we get to it. So let's go ahead and look at the monomyth here with 1,000 Faces. Anyone read Here with 1,000 Faces? It's an interesting read. As I mentioned in another week, it's very worth looking at. You should not use it as a guidebook, but use it as a tool. The difference between those two, in my opinion, is, again, this idea of, I need to have this versus, if I added this piece, it would make my story better for these reasons. Okay? Keep that in mind. The monomyth is basically kind of looking at three-act format, or maybe three-act format is a way of looking at the monomyth, with some specific ideas attached to it that commonly show up in science fiction and fantasy. So I do want to talk about it. The monomyth, instead of describing in three acts, though, describes a circle. So the idea behind the monomyth is this idea that you have a character who starts at point A. At this point, they are going to cross a threshold. And you could kind of say this is your first act. The idea is you have a character who's kind of ignorant but at peace, and something forces them into motion. Usually they have a meeting with a mentor. Or they have some sort of experience early in their in the story that indicates to them that they are going to have to change. That they can no longer remain the person that they are. And the crossing of threshold one is them acknowledging that they are willing to change. That's kind of what this idea means. The mentor is a big figure in the monomyth because it's kind of it's one of these tonal promises. The promise of, here is this wise mentor, your job is to become like them, right? Your job, Luke, is to turn into Obi-Wan. Your job, Harry, is to be a wizard like Dumbledore. Your job is to look at this mentor and get the promise of tone as a reader that this mentor is going to guide the hero and the hero is then going to adopt some of the attributes of the mentor. So they cross a threshold. And the monomyth is big on this idea of thresholds because it's big on the idea of that this is home and this is what we call... the strange world. This world is weird. There's something bizarre about it. It's mystical. It is a different place. It's the special world. Usually, in here in the monomyth, there is at least one refusal. They did this very well in the Lord of the Rings. The Hobbit movies. The Hobbit movies. You know, they have their problems, but one thing that they did really well is this character of Bilbo Baggins. And if you haven't seen them, at the beginning, you know, Bilbo is at home in a peaceful setting. Everything's great. And then these dwarves show up and start ruining his life, and he doesn't want to go be the thief, and he refuses, and they leave without him. And then he has this moment of, I need to change. There's something wrong in my life. I've turned down this opportunity to go on adventure, and it was the wrong thing to do. And he literally just chases after them. You see him going, hey, wait, I'm going to go be your thief. And that's this idea of he's willing to go into the strange world and cross the threshold, leave Hobbiton, and go on an adventure. And the middle part, and the monomyth is much, you know, you can kind of see how beginning and end are a half the size of the middle. The middle act of the monomyth is this idea of, where you are entering the trials. A lot of this was based off the ancient Greek myths and plays and ideas there. You're entering a world of trial where you're going to be tested, sometimes in threes. Three was a big thing to Joseph Campbell with the idea of trials. And there will be these tests to who you are, and eventually you will die. It might be figurative. They call it entering the underworld. You may go into the underworld to retrieve somebody, but you will die in some way. This is the equivalent of, you know, the being at your worst point. There is some sort of metaphor for death for the hero in the monomyth. There's usually a loss of a mentor somewhere in here, and there's usually a boon. Usually there's some sort of magical gift granted to the hero that is just given to them. Whether it is Harry Potter, for some reason, Voldemort being near makes your scar burn and, you know, you are like anti-Voldemort, he's matter and you're anti-matter or vice versa. You've got some sort of special power given to you. There's supernatural aid. This is kind of a big part of it. And then there's kind of this idea that you pull out of the underworld, and this actually happens in the second act, quote unquote, in the monomyth, with this idea of resurrection. And then there's a moment of apotheosis, kind of coming to understand God in a moment of kind of peace and understanding and serenity or whatever, followed by the return. Usually there's also kind of the there's the theft or gaining of power. There's something, the elixir, he often calls it in the monomyth. The hero has gained something. The last part is return. Sometimes it's a flight, an actual running. Sometimes it's more contemplative. Usually there's a refusal. In this one as well, I don't want to go home, but I know I need to. And then the hero returns home with the elixir, as representation that the hero has now returned home to give to the people who are still at home of the knowledge and has then become the mentor for the people who are still at home. So this is a cool storytelling tool. It can be very helpful. But again, you got to ask yourself the whys. why do these things happen? Why are they important to your story? Let's go through a few of them and ask ourselves the whys just to get this started. We don't have time in the class to, you know, we could probably spend an entire course on, hey, here's the monomyth. Let's talk about the why of this today. But tell me, so why the refusal? Why the initial refusal? What does that accomplish in your story? Yeah.
I believe it makes them a little bit more human.
Yeah.
Somebody willingly likes change.
Yeah. I would say that's the biggest part, but there's definitely more. But yeah, nobody likes change. This character is like us. Go ahead.
It's also a promise, because you know if they refuse at this point and they're not going to change after this point, then there's no book.
Right.
You know that if in their refusal that it's not really a refusal, they're going to have to use.
Right, right. There's some tension there, but there's also kind of this momentum. Yeah, go ahead. Go for it.
It shows that your character isn't flat. They have opinions, they have motivation, and they have room to say no and then to change their mind.
Yeah, that's excellent. They have opinions. They have room to say no. They could just stay there. In fact, oftentimes in these stories, someone will stay behind. As the hero goes out, they'll leave somebody behind who's not willing to cross the threshold to kind of show this idea. I often say, when you're designing a character, this goes back to last week, it's really important for you to understand who this character is and what they would be doing with their life if the plot had never hit them. I believe I said that a couple weeks ago. Who are they and what would they be doing? And ask yourself this for the side characters as well as the primary character, because otherwise you risk having, you know, the idea that the main character is somewhat dynamic, they have agency, they're making choices in their life, whereas all the side characters are just, you know, don't seem like they would exist except to enhance the main character's existence and the story that they're telling. Stay away from that. It makes the story feel flat, and it can be really offensive depending on how you do it. So that's why we have the refusal. Why the loss of the mentor? Yes?
Well, if the goal of the story is to become like the mentor, to replace the mentor, it doesn't make sense that, like, then there's no story. And also, if the mentor is there to help you out, that, you know, it adds tension when they're gone. You have to deal with it yourself, deal with the problems yourself.
Yeah, excellent. Very good. You have to deal with the problems yourself, and if you're going to replace the mentor, then, yeah, having the mentor there. Go ahead.
Like she said, you're going to fill in what's missing from the character, fill in the rest of the promises, become the independent.
Right.
Or able to do it himself, become the mentor when he goes home.
Become the mentor when he comes home, become independent. Yeah, I mean, I think this one's pretty obvious. Let's talk about, I think you guys can figure out the death and resurrection, kind of the low point idea. What's this idea? This was really important to him, apotheosis. Can anyone say, like, the original, what it actually means? It's Latin, isn't it? Yeah.
Become a god.
Become a god, yeah. So, in this, it's like becoming like the gods. It also, he talks a lot about a moment of peace and understanding of the world and the character's place in it. Why is this part of the monomyth? Yeah.
Well, if he didn't gain anything from this journey, it was kind of a big waste of time.
Yeah, if you didn't gain anything from the journey, it's a big waste of time. Go ahead.
Also, I kind of like that this happens before the resolution, because, like, you needed this thing that you discovered to be able to have a resolution.
Right. You need that moment of understanding before the resolution happens. Now, sometimes it happens, you know, in some of these books right before. Like, this ending is rushed. In Star Wars, I would say it's the moment where Luke turns off the guidance computer, right? Where he's like, oh, I understand the Force. I trust the Force. I have a moment where this is who I am. I don't use a guidance computer, I'm a Jedi. And he turns off the guidance computer. That's what that means, and that's kind of Luke's moment. Not a big moment in that story, because it's an action movie with lots of explosions. In other stories, you'll have an entire chapter where the character's like, ah, and they're kind of reflective, and they've got this kind of transcendent moment. What else might this do? Go for it.
If a character's refusing the call, possibly they don't understand, like, the importance of what they're doing, of the story, the moral implications, right?
Yeah.
And as they're going through the trials and fully learning about it, maybe there's a point of, like, emotional resolution, like, it was worth it.
Right, right. Yeah. So if you dig into things like this, you might say, you know what, I don't want any of this other stuff, but that moment we just talked about, that's a cool moment, and I think I should have that in my story, because this is the first time my character's really become self-aware is near this ending, and I should have a moment for the character like that. So be asking yourself these questions, ask them in your writing groups, talk about them, start figuring out how you want to storytell. All right. Let's talk about a few quick ones for pantsers to help you out, and then we'll get into the last one, which I didn't put on the board, which is kind of the Brandon method of plotting. So for pantsers, I have two kind of general suggestions that I've seen work. One is the idea of try-fail cycles. When I took this class from Dave, he talked a lot about the concept of a try-fail cycle. And he talked about this idea of rising action that you may have seen in school. And he says, this is too simple for it to be really that useful to a writer. What he said is, if you do this, suddenly it starts to make sense to a writer. That is that you occasionally have these fallbacks even though motion is progressing. He suggests this idea of anything that you want to have a nice moment in the story, the characters tie at least twice, maybe three times to resolve and have something go wrong with that resolution. Now, along these lines, the other method that I've heard work is the one that, Mary from the podcast Ranks uses, Mary Robinette Cole talks about, which is the yes, but, no, and. This is a plotting method for people who are pantsing, who are discovery writing, and this is where you introduce a problem, like in the first few pages. Introduce a problem. Have the character try to resolve it, and then you ask yourself, does it work? If you answer yes, you add a but. Yes, it works, but something else goes wrong. And if what they try doesn't work, you say no, and it gets worse for this reason, and you can keep doing that until the end of the story. Sounds really simple, but let's talk through how this might work. So what's a conflict you can introduce on page 2 of a book? Give me a conflict. Yeah. Little brother gets lost. Little brother is lost in the big city. You were at shopping. Then the character turns around and her little brother that she's been tasked with taking care of is gone. Okay? What is something she can try to do to find the little brother? Run around screaming his name. Okay. Does running around screaming his name work? Someone tell me.
No.
No?
Yes.
Yes, it does work. She finds him, but...
But you find out that he was turning away on purpose, and so it's hard to find him now, and he gets away.
Okay, so you find him, but you find out that he has some sort of issue where he doesn't want to be with you, and now you've got this conflict between yourself and your brother because your brother hates you, okay? She tries to resolve her brother hating her. How does she try to resolve this? Yeah, raise your hands. Yeah.
Pretzels.
Pretzels. She buys him pretzels. Does it work? Raise your hands. Yes, go ahead.
No.
No, what? No, and, or yeah, no, and.
And a dinosaur escapes from the zoo.
And a dinosaur escapes from the zoo. Okay, they go to the zoo and buy pretzels. She buys a pretzel for him. She's like, here's a pretzel. He's like, great, I let the T-Rex out. I'm hoping he'll eat you. You can see how this would work. You want to string it together into causality, so it's not just random events, so that there are reasons and motivations and things like this, but it can go silly if you want it to. This is a way of telling a story where you just keep doing that, and it just keeps getting worse and worse and worse, and you let it snowball. The trick to it is what I did when I was talking to you, which is to remember character motivation, work character motivation into things that are happening so they're not completely random, and causality so that the characters are doing things and are proactive rather than them just happening. All right? So, any question about the monomyth or these kind of weird pantsing methods?
Would there be a point where it's like exhausting for the reader just to always get a lot of yes buts or no?
Yes. So the question is, is there a point where it can get exhausting to the reader? Books that do this all the way through, sometimes do. A book that does this is Battlefield Earth. The book is better than the movie, but it does this basically the whole book. It's just like it's a never-ending string of this guy, you know, Johnny, whatever his name is, be like, all right, I fixed that problem. Eh, what did you people do to make this worse? Okay, I've stopped that. Oh, they've not launched the nuclear missiles. And it just keeps going, and it gets exhausting. A lot of thrillers do this. A lot of thrillers, the Dan Brown books, basically are an endless yes but no and until the ending. It works in a book that you're supposed to just sit down and read in one sitting or two sittings better than in a book like this because of that fatigue. But there are ways to get beyond this. There are ways to, and the main way to get beyond that would be to be nesting your plot cycles so that certain things are being resolved while other things are still ongoing. So the reader has moments of, we finally accomplished that. That plot cycle is resolved, okay? The argument with her father, she and her father have come to terms. We are done with that. Now let's deal with the T-Rex, right? And that's part of the way that you do this. Let's talk about, for the last 20 minutes or so, last 10 minutes or so, Brandon's plotting method. So I don't use any of these, though they're all used. I don't have time for questions right now. We gotta keep moving on. You can ask me later on. These are all tools that I'm aware of and that help me. But I don't sit down and say, okay, what are my acts? What I ask myself is I start building in my outline a series of promises and great moments I want to fulfill. I will just write them down. I'll say, okay, I want to have, I'll do this for Mistborn. Sorry if any of this is spoilers, but all right, we've got a romance. All right, and so I've got a romance where female lead and male lead hook up. Right? So I've got that as one of the things I want to have happen. I have overthrowing the empire. That is one of the plot cycles that I want to have happen at the end of this book. Part of the pitch for Mistborn was I wanted to do what a lot of books do in an 8-book series. I'm going to do it in one book. That was the kind of the concept, the pitch for it. So we're going to overthrow the empire. We are going to, Vin learns magic. So by the end of that, by the end of the first book, I want Vin to be really good at the magic. So we kind of have this thing. We have, the mystery. In order to do this, we need to kill the Lord Ruler. So we have a mystery. How can you kill an immortal? Yeah. And I just start putting these up here. And there will be lots of them for a book that I'm writing, particularly for an epic fantasy. These are all my different goals. And usually they're attached to really cool scenes or moments that I have imagined in my head. And what I start doing is I start saying, how do I earn this? And I start bullet pointing, all right? And oftentimes, bullet pointing will lead me to say, I need to do something. I need to do, Vin learns to trust, right? Main character cannot have a romance if she's not learned how to trust, because she's had a life that has taught her you can't trust anybody. And so I start building this one. I say, okay, what are moments that are going to lead me along this path? And what I am looking for is progression. I talked about this idea of progression. Readers turn the page and feel like their book is moving and are having an exciting time almost always because they are seeing little progress and it is making them feel excited. I learned this once, an aspect of this, by reading a book called Inferno by Larry Niven and Jerry Pournelle. It's a great book. It's about a science fiction writer who's at a party, gets drunk, and falls out a window and dies, and wakes up in Dante's Inferno. That's the afterlife. And this story, what's interesting about it is simply a series of vignettes. It's almost like a series of short stories as he travels through Dante's Inferno, encounters famous historical figures who are under different names doing different things in hell, and eventually, tries to get out of the Inferno. And it was really exciting. I'm like, why is this really exciting? It's just a series otherwise isolated events. And what I realized was they had a nice map in the beginning that showed where the character started on the outskirts and had him pointed right at the center of this map. And I'm like, oh, I gotta know what's at the center. And I vaguely remembered. And I'm like, oh, you know, I've gotta read. And this idea of every little adventure was one step closer to an ending was in itself enough of a sense of progress that I enjoyed this story, despite the fact that it otherwise didn't seem to, you know, have a lot of connected parts. A lot of travel logs exist to do this. Lord of the Rings, the plot of the Lord of the Rings is, here's Mordor, here's Frodo and team, that's a long ways, and one does not simply walk into Mordor. And so we get to see them going along. Now, of course, Lord of the Rings has a ton of other cool stuff going on. You know, it has the friendship between elf and dwarf represented by two characters. It has, you know, kind of Frodo's being corrupted. This is a great example of a character arc that goes down, right? It has all these cool other things going on, but the framework of it is we've got to get from point A to point B, and you can follow along. Being able to follow along is very useful. And so, really what I'm doing in my books when I'm doing an outline is I try to define different types of promises and different types of subplots. And I kind of split these up in my head. You can find your own for what these would be. You don't have to use mine. But you have things like, you have mysteries. You have romances. Actually, it's really just relationships. Because buddy cop movies and romance movies actually follow the same plot. They really do. You've got relationships, you've got mysteries, you've got travelogues. You've got, what's another one? You've got time bombs, which is not really its own one. It's just kind of often attached to one of these. If we don't do this by this time, something terrible happens. You have the character arc, the overcome internal problem, overcome a flaw by the main character. Vin needs to learn to trust again. Was it you who asked me the question, or was it around here? It was you that asked the question. You said, I've got a primarily internal character thing. Well, you can do this same stuff. You just identify what is this thing the character's working on, what is their internal journey, and then you put it in its own thing, and you start writing bullet points. What are steps along the way? How can I indicate to the reader the motion, whether down or up, that's going on? You have moments then in your story where, you know, Frodo's journey is mostly internal, despite the fact that he's crossing all this. Him as a character, it's internal. And you have moments that show that he's getting corrupted by the ring, where he's putting it on more and more, where he doesn't want to let someone else hold it, where he's, you know, becoming like we saw happen to Smeagol and things like this. Those internal things have some outward manifestations, and that's always a good idea, but brainstorm your points along so that when you put them in a story, the reader says, ah, I get that. I see. We are moving. We're not staying in the same place. The last thing you want the reader to say is, this is getting boring because nothing is happening. You can have a story that takes place in one room with one character that is not boring because things are happening, even though it's all happening kind of inside of one person. So you need to start giving this sense of progress. You just need to be thinking about why they're going to turn the page. Now, when I'm done, I have all of these things with all these bullet points, right? I'll maybe have 10 or 12 of them. I build a book by going and saying, okay, I'm going to grab, you know, the first one, you know, let's say this is the end point. This is the first one I've come up with that I brainstormed that I like. I didn't use all of these, but feels like a step along the way. Okay, Vin meets Ellen at the ball. And, you know, there's these certain things that make them seem like they would work together and certain things that make them seem like they wouldn't, right? I take that and I say, okay, I'm going to mix that with a Vin character moment. I'm going to take those two things and I'm going to build a scene out of that. The characters first meet, and also Vin has been working on this, like, you know, overcoming her internal demons, and I'm going to show a moment where, okay, she has this moment of, I can do this. I've stuffed my demons down behind, my insecurities, and so you have the scene in Mistborn, if you've read it, where Vin enters the ball and realizes, you know, yes, I can do this. It's like putting on a costume. They're not seeing me. It's a step along the way for gaining back kind of her self-confidence and trust, and also she meets Ellen. And so I just grab a bunch of these things and I build a scene out of them, an interesting setting, and these are all kind of my moments along. Now, to do these well, you need to make sure there's conflict. You need to make sure there's red herrings. You need to make sure that the clues are adding up together, and you need to make sure that your sense of your bullet points match the type of plot that you are doing. For instance, a mystery, your bullet points are, what are steps towards solving mystery?
Clues.
Clues. Your bullet points are clues. Relationships, your bullet points are character moments of interaction between the two of them where you show why they'd be good for each other, or perhaps where they rub each other the wrong way, things like this. You know, your travelogue, your points are places on the map, right? And so you kind of look at these things and try to match these moments building up to something cool with the tone of each of these. And this is kind of how you nest multiple plots together and multiple subplots. Often you'll like toss, it's like tossing 40 footballs in the air and then catching them one at a time at the other end of the end zone. All right? Okay, so we're going to talk world building next week. Make sure you turn your sheets in. If you have any questions about all of this, go ahead and write it down and we'll start next week with questions. I want to let you get going. So thank you guys very much. Oh, thank you. Yeah. You don't need to clap just because we're on film, but it does, you know.